20 degrees, 25 to 20, and
hello my friends, welcome to episode 60C, Genesis 30, the notes. I'm going to read the concordance notes from Genesis 30 in this episode. Bilhah, Rachel's maid, became a surrogate for Rachel, as Hagar was for Sarah. Two sons were born in this manner for Rachel: Dan, God is my judge, and Naphtal, meaning my wrestling. Those were the sons of Bilhah, Rachel's maid, and she was embarrassed that she couldn't get pregnant, so she sent in Bilhah, her servant, to have sex with Jacob, because Rachel wanted kids, and she didn't want to she didn't want Jacob to be mad at her, because he married her expecting children, and it was her duty. So her the common thing back then was to get another woman to have babies for her and her husband, if that girl didn't have a husband. So Rachel's maid Bilhah had two sons, Dan and Naphtal. And they would raise them as their, as Rachel and Jacob's sons. Zilpah, Leah's maid, also became a surrogate. She gave birth to two sons for her mistress. Leah was Jacob's first wife. She was Rachel's older sister. Apparently, she was having some problems getting pregnant also, and she had her servant Zilpah to have sex with Jacob in order that to please Jacob, because Jacob wanted children. It was Leah's duty, responsibility, to provide children to Jacob, and so she had her maid, who was not married, provide those children, because Leah was having trouble conceiving. So Zilpah's two sons, Gad, meaning a troop, and Asher, meaning happy, and she presented them to Jacob as her sons for her and Jacob to share. Now, mandrakes were considered an aphrodisiac and a stimulant for conception in some cultures. Mandrake is a root that kind of looks like ginger, and a lot of times it'll look like a man. It'll have two legs and two arms and a head. And so Rachel schemed to get the mandrakes, but Leah got pregnant. So often people scheme and plan only to see the opposite of what they want. This happens when people seek to do their own will instead of God's. Leah gave birth to three more children. Oh, so Leah still was fertile, and she had her own children. Sons, Issachar, meaning wages, Zebulun, meaning dwelling, and a daughter, Dinah, meaning judgment. Leah recognized God as the one who endowed her with children. From Eve, from Eve, onward, Scripture always attributes the conception of a child to the grace of God, which only makes sense. That's why I get so mad when I hear of kids dying or little babies being killed. Like sometimes, anyway, that gets me mad. Anyway, so years of barrenness so deeply affected Rachel that she felt as if God remembered and listened to her when she finally conceived. When Scripture says God remembers someone, it means He will soon act on behalf of that person. An all-knowing God cannot forget anyone. Jacob's agreement with Laban and his position as an adopted son meant he could not be sent away to live independently unless Laban allowed it. Moses' circumstances with Reuel, also called Jethro, and Midian were similar. Jacob's clever plan for his wages, choosing the atypical animals, made them easy to distinguish, and meant Laban could not cheat on the deal. Because the spotted ones and the marked ones were his, and the unicolored ones were Laban's. But Jacob used little tricks to stimulate the females going into heat with a different visual things. He'd put a different color stick here or there when the girls were going to heat, and then eventually when they saw those sticks, they would go into heat. And so he started kind of genetically engineering the colored ones, the spotted ones, and the striped ones to go to him and to multiply, and the solid colored ones to be more weak and to have less children. So his wealth was growing through this genetic engineering. This meant Laban could not cheat on the deal, because it was obvious. The colored ones were hit, the spotted ones were Jacob's, the solid colored ones were Laban's. Plain and simple. Using colored rods might seem like magic, but they are symbols of Jacob's use of selective breeding, all within the context of trusting in God's provision. So Jacob did this knowing that God was blessing everything he did. So he can basically, everything he set his mind to would succeed. And so he was confident that this would work, and it did. This reminds me of something I struggle with, and I noticed other people I've come into contact, a lot of people I know I come into contact with, struggle with, which is knowing that whatever he does would be blessed. Well, I've only got 1 minute, but you see, I have a something in my subconscious that right before I might get a raise, or I meet a guy that would be a good friend. Right before I get the raise, I'll quit the job, or I will insult the manager. Or I meet a guy that would be a good friend, and so I insult him, and then he gets mad at me, and so we don't become friends. Or a girl, the relationship is going really good, and so I will do something stupid, insult her somehow, and then the relationship ends. It's called self-sabotage, and I am working on this right now. See, Jacob knew that he was blessed by God, so everything he tried would be successful. So I'm trying to reprogram myself. See, that happens because of something that happens to you when you're a child. You have no control over it. It could be a friend, a family member, a storekeeper. Somebody said something to you that made you think that you are not worthy of success. You are not worthy of respect. You are not going to be rich. You are not going to have a good relationship. Because they'll say, oh, that won't work to you. And if you're a kid and this older person tells you that, or a person that you respect, a friend, you think they're really smart, you're going to believe that and internalize that. It becomes part of your core beliefs. I'm trying to I'm trying to change that, my core beliefs right now, to that I am worthy of respect. I'm worthy of a good relationship. I'm worthy of a good friendship. I'm worthy of a good job and a successful business. I gotta go.